From St. Paul's Baptist Church, here's the scoop.
Hurt but not hindered, how to move forward. You don't want to miss it. Join us for the Bridge Bible Study every Thursday at 11 a.m. and 7 p.m. It's streamed across all of our platforms. Invite your friends and family. Download the student outline from our website at myspbc.org or text the word INSIDER to 804-643-4769 to receive it automatically each week. Invite someone to watch with you.
You may not realize it, but the health of your soul is affected by what you experience in life. The ups and downs, challenges, and stress. Caring for your soul goes a long way in keeping you steady, filled with peace, and growing in wisdom. After a year in pandemic, we are all in need of repair. Join our senior pastor, Dr. Lance Watson, for this insightful series as he leads us on a journey of soul repair. Invite somebody to share it with you.
Rain or shine, our fresh food distribution will take place on both June 10th and 24th. Over 1,000 fresh food boxes will be given away. No registration, just show up and pick up at 29 Elm Street, Petersburg, Virginia from 2 to 4 p.m., at 700 East Belt Boulevard in Richmond from 4 to 6 p.m., or at 4247 Creighton Road, Henrico, Virginia from 4 to 6 p.m., or until all food is gone. This is in partnership with Feed More, Produce Source Partners, Save-A-Lot, and Anthem Healthkeepers Plus. Mask is required. Questions? Email outreach at myspbc.org to volunteer. The rising cost of higher education is one of the biggest foes facing us today. Yet our mission remains the same as our ancestors: to nudge our students to be all that God created them to be. Our faith in God has given us the power to open the doors to opportunity by creating educational scholarships to help our students realize their potential. During the month of June, we are asking every St. Paul supporter to give a special gift of $50 towards our scholarship fund. You can give digitally, online, or by sending a check in the mail. You can designate your gift scholarship to fund gifts for this year or legacy scholarships to help us build a scholarship endowment for the future. Through our Legacy Scholarships program, you can create scholarships to be given in honor of loved ones or yourself. All gifts are tax-deductible, charitable donations. Join us in giving during the month of June.
Never would have made it. Never could have made it without you.
Hello, everybody. My name is Jayla Wilder, and I am a member of the College Connect group here at St. Paul's Baptist Church. I just want to give a special thank you to the St. Paul's Community Foundation for blessing me with this amazing scholarship. I am grateful and thankful for this opportunity that they have given me. It is truly a blessing, and I want to thank you guys again for this opportunity. And I will continue to make you guys proud as I continue my education through college. Thank you again.
Good evening. My name is Malik Grant, and I'm a member of the Blueprint Life Stage of SMB. I'm in the College Connect group, and I also volunteer as a math tutor for SMB. I'm a past recipient of the St. Paul's Community Foundation Scholarship Award, for which I am thankful. Scholarship funds allow me the opportunity to pursue my goal of obtaining a college education by helping to minimize my out-of-pocket expenses, making it affordable for my family and I. I'm a senior this year at VCU, majoring in mathematical sciences with a minor in chemistry. After graduating next year, earning my bachelor's degree, I plan to continue my education, applying to the School of Pharmacy in hopes to pursue my career goal of becoming a pharmacist. I would like to thank the St. Paul's Community Foundation for planting a seed in my life. I would also like to thank the community for their continued support of the foundation through donations. This makes it possible for them to continue to give it to other students like myself who are looking to further their education. Please continue to support the foundation. Thank you.
The
The St. Paul's Community Foundation will host its annual golf tournament on Friday, September 10th. Proceeds from the tournament support scholarships for our students pursuing higher education. Don't miss the prizes, food, and fun. For information and registration, visit www.mysbbc.info/spcf_2021golf. We are honored and want to celebrate you for accomplishing such an awesome milestone. We are celebrating all 2021 graduates on Sunday, June 27th, during the 10 a.m. worship service. Please email a clear photo of the graduate with their first and last name to deco@myspbc.org by Tuesday, June 15th. Graduates, drive through our North Campus, 4247 Creighton Road from 3 to 4 p.m. on Sunday, June 27th to pick up a congratulatory gift. Please wear your cap and gown and register at myspbc.info/gradsun21. That's GRADSUN21. You are invited to participate in a research study about perceptions and belief regarding the COVID-19 vaccine. Your participation is voluntary. In this study, you will be asked a set of questions about the COVID-19 vaccine. The survey will take approximately 8 minutes to complete. Participation is voluntary and you can exit the survey anytime you want. Here's the link, www.myspbc.info/COVID-vaccine. We give praise to God for our new members thus far in 2021. Every new member is required to complete our DNA seminar. It's a one-day, 90-minute introduction to our church family. The next seminar for adults will convene on Zoom on Monday, June 7th at 6:30 p.m. The next seminar for kids is Sunday, June 27th at 12:30 p.m. Visit myspbc.info/DNA for Zoom login info. Connect with us for one-on-one prayer or counseling at any time during our Sunday morning worship experience. We'd love to talk with you. Join us in our virtual gathering room at www.myspbc.info/gatheringroom. This year, we will select a governor, lieutenant governor. Make sure you vote. Here are some important dates to take note of during this primary election. June 5th, last day of in-person absentee voting at local registrar. June 8th is election day. Find out who your local legislators are at myspbc.info/local-legislature. Check out the Virginia Citizen portal to update your registration. Check your polling location and more at elections.virginia.gov/citizen-portal.
Thank you for your time and attention. This has been The Scoop. Thank you.
This is the day the Lord has made. We should rejoice and be glad in it. God is an awesome God who rules heaven, earth, and the cosmos with love and mercy, peace, and power. We praise God for the ability to celebrate God's goodness on this Memorial Day weekend. We pause to celebrate all of those who have given their lives on behalf of all of the people, ideals, and values of this country. Having said that, let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you for the gift of life. We thank you for health and strength. We thank you for waking us up today and giving us back our right mind, for watching over us all night long. We thank you for those who fight for and protect our freedoms and our liberties, for the high aspirations and ideals that we hold as a people. Give us the courage now this weekend, not only to remember, but to recommit ourselves to being our best selves, our highest selves, our greatest selves, every single day of our lives. Bless us now as we worship together in your name. For it's in the name of Jesus that we give you all praise and glory. Amen. And I want to welcome you, my friends, on this Memorial Day weekend to St. Paul's Everywhere. We are touching the world with love by finding needs and meeting them, finding problems and solving them, finding hurts and healing them. Out of all the places and spaces and pages where you could have paused your cursor or stopped your finger, you have stopped here, and we are glad to have you. Wait, no, you deserve a big word. We are hippopotamus happy. No, you deserve another one. We are elephant excited to have you share with us in worship today. And there are a number of ways in which you can engage with us right now. If you are brand new, you can text that word new, N-E-W, to 804-643-4769 and let us welcome you. If you're on social media, you can pause right now. Look at the name in front of you. Look at the name behind you and greet those people using their tag, using their name, using their logon ID, and just say to them, Happy Memorial Day. Good to see you online. Good to see you in service. If you're at home and you're watching on your television, your computer, or your iPad, if there's someone there with you, greet them and say to them, Happy Memorial Day. If you're physically alone, call somebody on the phone and tell them, get online. You need to share this service with me, coming from the St. Paul's Baptist Church. We want you to engage, not just passively watch. If you like something, hit the like button. If you think of somebody you want to bless, hit the share button. If the message or the music speaks to you, feel free to comment in the chat. Post your emoji. Use your life stage color. Our main point is always, we want to worship with you. Oh, come, let us bow down. Oh, come, let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. We want to worship with you, not for you, for God is a spirit, and they that worship God must worship God in spirit and in truth. So let's get after it right now.
Good morning, church. My name is Barbara Gardner. I am a refiner, and I just would like to offer you a few words of encouragement. Church, you can depend on the love of God and the love and care of your church family. Be blessed, stay encouraged, and have a nice day.
I love to praise Him today. To praise Him today. I love to praise Him every day.
sing with me. I love to praise. It's holy. One more time.
Wonderful day to be alive, my brothers and sisters. God is great and worthy to be praised. And yes, there is a word from the Lord. We're in a series called Soul Repair. It's an encouragement based on Scripture to take a moment to reflect upon the condition of our soul and to make, by the grace of God, the needed repairs. Today, we travel to the scriptural territory of Psalm 91, a very familiar passage, but go there with me, and I'd like to read in your hearing verses 1 through 7, as we tackle the topic, facing fear. Listen for a word from God. Those who live in the shelter of the Most High will find rest in the shadow of the Almighty. This I declare about the Lord. He alone is my refuge, my place of safety. He is my God, and I trust him. For he will rescue you from every trap and protect you from deadly disease. He will cover you with his feathers. He will shelter you with his wings. His faithful promises are your armor and protection. Do not be afraid of the terrors of the night, nor the arrow that flies in the day. Do not dread the disease that stalks in darkness, nor the disaster that strikes at midday. Though 1,000 fall at your side, though 10,000 are dying around you, these evils will not touch you. The word of God for the people of God. All praise be to God. People are afraid of all kinds of things. You might be surprised to find out what the fears of your family and friends are. And I point to them because some of us will never admit that we are afraid of anything. But for the rest of the world, you might be surprised to discover that people are afraid of all kinds of things. There are over 500 identifiable fears and phobias about which we know that threaten terror and provoke dread in the lives of people. There is glossophobia, the fear of public speaking. There is agoraphobia, the fear of open spaces, brontophobia, the fear of thunder or lightning, necrophobia, the fear of death, arachnophobia is the fear of spiders that makes some people respond in an irrational way whenever a spider shows up. You almost jump out of your skin as if Satan himself had appeared in the spawn of an eight-legged insect. Some people have arachnophobia, or fear of acrophobia, rather, fear of heights. And if you get them more than 10 feet off the ground and have them look over a ledge, they would just about lose their mind. Some people are xenophobic, and they're quick to profile anybody of another ethnicity, color, or race. Claustrophobia is a fear of tight spaces. So those are the people who like to sit all by themselves, even in a packed church. I came up with one. Some of us are policophobia. We see a police officer and we immediately get nervous and don't let them pull us over or drive up behind us. Howard Hughes was so afraid of germs that he used 4 boxes of tissue paper every day, wiping off everything he touched. Evel Knievel, the daredevil stuntman, was afraid of airplanes. Augustus Caesar was afraid to sit in the dark. The Queen of Soul, Aretha Franklin, suffered from aerophobia, believe it or not. As talented and as gifted as she was afraid to board an airplane and fly anywhere. The point I'm arguing is that all kinds of people are afraid of all kinds of things. And yet you might be encouraged to note that there are effective therapies and therapists for all manner of fears and phobias around us. Counseling, yoga, and beta blockers are big business. It's seismic industry engineered to help human beings face and fight their fears, reduce their racing heartbeat, and helping them to embrace our fragile disposition so that we might claim some level of normalcy again. You can make a lot of money trying to help people find serenity in our world today because fears and phobias abound. Can I talk to you for a moment? Because I wonder today, what are your fears? What are your phobias? Have you ever wondered why you fear the things you fear? How did you learn how to fear what you fear? Believe it or not, a major contributor, according to researchers, to the development of our fears are our parents, that we do and fear what our parents did. Studies show that our acquisition of fears and their negative influence is largely determined by what our parents have modeled before us. We learn how to handle fear and what to be afraid of from our family. Mothers are not only modeling for their daughters how to be women, and fathers are not only modeling for their sons how to be men, but together you are teaching your children how to manage fear and what to be afraid of in the world. What are your fears? I repeat, what are your phobias? I don't mean the trivial things, but the terrible things. Of what are you afraid? What frightens you to the point of paralysis? You should know, parenthetically speaking, that 60% of the things we fear will never take place. 30% of the things we fear are things that happened in the past and cannot be changed. 10% of the things we fear are going to happen anyway. So our fear may not be rational, but it is real. The songwriter of Psalm 91 writes metaphorically in this Hebrew hymn book about a number of fears and phobias that confronted the ancients in his time, and undoubtedly that still antagonize many of us today. Psalm 91 is one of the so-called orphan psalms, called that way because we do not know the author of this psalm. The Septuagint ascribes it to David, while others ascribe it to Moses, but no one knows for sure. Likewise, we do not know the occasion that prompted the writing of this psalm. Nothing in the psalm points to its historical background. Even the structure of the psalm is somewhat hard to ascertain, as multiple voices apparently speak in this one psalm. Yet the message of Psalm 91 is clear, and I want you to get it, that those who trust in the Lord have no reason to fear. Psalm 91 is also considered a messianic psalm that finds its fulfillment ultimately in the Lord Jesus Christ. In the dialogue of Matthew's Gospel, chapter 4, verse 5, Satan, the adversary, the nemesis, the enemy, the devil, applies this psalm to Jesus. Jesus does not deny that it is about him, even though he resists Satan's temptation to put God to the test. The promises of God in this psalm are ultimately fulfilled in the Lord Jesus Christ. But let there be no mistake, Psalm 91 is good news for everyone and anyone who puts their trust in God. Because while Psalm 90 is a warning about the reality of death, Psalm 91 is a promise of protection for life. Martin Luther called this psalm the most distinguished jewel among all the psalms of consolation. This psalm must not be used to turn true faith into religious superstition, but the meaning of this psalm is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, that those who trust in the Lord have no reason to fear. Where's J.J. Harrison when you need him? That we can face our fears confidently and courageously because by faith we already have the victory. Let the whole church type already. Look at the endorsement offered in verse 5. Do not be afraid of the terrors of the night, those things you cannot and did not see coming. Look at verse 5b, nor the arrow that flies in the day, those things you can see coming, but like an arrow, they're coming so fast that you cannot avoid them or get out of the way. Look at verse 6a, do not dread the disease that walks in darkness, nor the disaster that strikes at midday, those things like COVID and cancer that potentially can destroy us. It does not matter, the psalmist concludes, if we face terror by day, arrows by night, diseases in darkness, or disaster at noonday. You may not have any time free from fear, but you can have a heart free from fear as you trust in Almighty God. verses 5 and 6 give us the bad news. But if we rewind this film to verses 1 through 4, it offers us good news to help us squarely face unhelpful, unholy, and unhealthy fears. Can I act like I'm Mavis Staples for a moment and take you there? Because the songwriter starts by inviting us to number 1, the secret place of prayer. Verse 1, he says, those who live in the shelter of the Most High will find rest in the shadow of the Almighty. Forgive my love of the King James Version here. It says, he who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. How reassuring it should be for all of us to know that when we get into trouble, when life comes caving in, when the walls fall down around us, when problems come, when sickness shows up and we don't know what to do, there is a secret place we can go to face our fears. We are invited to the secret place of prayer. In the New Testament Gospel of Matthew, chapter 6, verse 6, Jesus said, but when you pray, go away by yourself, shut the door behind you, and pray to the Father in secret. Then your Father, who sees everything, will reward you in the open. When you pray, don't babble on and on like the Gentiles do. They think that their prayers are answered merely by repeating their words again and again. Don't be like them. For your Father knows exactly what you need even before you ask him. The secret place of Psalm 91 is identical to the location lifted in Matthew 6. It's the secret place of prayer. Let me make it plain, friends. The secret to facing our fears is spending time in the secret place with God. Do you know why we struggle with that? Quite frankly, it's work. I know it is for me. I slip into my study and can spend hours preparing messages with ease, but to spend 30 minutes concentrated in prayer is often a struggle. I can stay focused studying the scripture for hours, engaging in exegesis and homiletics and hermeneutics, and yet get easily distracted after a few moments on my knees in prayer. 7 years ago this month, when I was diagnosed and had to have surgery for cancer, I battled a fear I had never known before. Have you ever played that mind game? How would I respond if I got cancer? Let me save you some time. Don't play it. You cannot simulate the emotional, psychological, and spiritual turmoil and unrest that comes when you've been told and diagnosed as having cancer. I battled a fear I had never known, but all praise be to God. I had a place to go with which I was familiar. I went to God in prayer. What's the point of prayer, preacher? I'm glad you asked. Is it to impress God? Absolutely not. Jesus said, when you pray, don't babble on and on like the Gentiles do. They think their prayers are answered merely by repeating their words again and again. Prayer is not an attempt to impress God. Is prayer to inform God? Absolutely not. You can't tell God anything that God doesn't already know. Did you hear me? God already knows. We don't pray to inform God. God already knows. You don't pray to impress God. Well, wait, if we don't pray to impress God or inform God, then what is the purpose of prayer? The purpose of prayer, the purpose of getting alone with God in prayer, is to invite God to join you in whatever you're going through. The text says, those who live in the shelter of the Most High, those who dwell in the secret place of the Most High, shall abide. Facing our fears starts in the secret place of prayer. And we will not be there long before God will go to work. because prayer is dipping your paintbrush onto the campus of omniscience. Prayer is coupling your weak hand with the hand of God's eternal omnipotence. Prayer is choosing the fellowship with the omnipresent one. Prayer is that element that moves both earth and heaven. Come here, A. Lewis Patterson. He said, when a man or woman gets down on their knees in prayer, they shake up three worlds at one time, because that prayer goes up to God as worship. It goes out to humanity as work, and it goes down to the devil as warfare. We've got to pray. Prayer is an invitation for God to join you in whatever you are going through. And you will not abide in that secret place before long, before you are ushered into number two, the sacred place of peace. Everybody say peace. I'm in this text. Those who live in the shelter of the Most High, here it is, will find rest in the shadow of the Almighty. This is a contextual reference to the most sacred place in the Jewish temple, a place they call the Holy of Holies. In the ancient Hebrew temple, there was an outer court, an inner court, and the innermost court, which was called the sacred place or the Holy of Holies. In the sacred place was the Ark of the Covenant. Atop the Ark of the Covenant was a slab of gold called the mercy seat. On both sides of the mercy seat were cherubim, angels with outstretched wings over the seat of mercy. These ancient Hebrews believed that the mercy seat was the resting place of the Shekinah glory of God, their name for the manifest presence of God in the midst of the people. This is the context of Psalm 91. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide or rest in the shadow of the Almighty. Right there on the mercy seat, right there where those wings are stretched out, that's where you'll be. This found the assurance in the hope that the secret place was also a sacred place. Don't miss a metaphor here that the writer says God is like a shelter to those that trust in God. God will cover you. Is there a witness online? Is there anybody who can testify that in what you've been going through, God has been covering you? He covered me, preacher, in the sick room. He covered me, preacher, in the courtroom. He covered me, preacher, in the midst of my creditors. He covered me, preacher, when the doctor said they couldn't do anything else. He covered me when my children were in trouble. God is like a shelter. Psalm 27 verse 5 says, for in the day of trouble, he will keep me safe in his dwelling. He will hide me in the shelter of his sacred tent and set me up high upon a rock. My enemies will be able to see me, but they won't be able to get to me. God is like a shelter, but he goes on to say, God is like a shadow for those who trust in God. A human shadow sometimes produces fear, but the divine shadow gives us comfort and faith. It means that God is near to provide relief, comfort, and deliverance. There is a shadow available to the children of God where we can find relief from the heat of exhaustive and extenuating circumstances. And that shadow is and signifies the very presence of God. It is in God's presence that we experience peace that surpasses all understanding. It's in God's presence that we know a joy that the world cannot give and the world cannot take away. Warren Wiersbe wrote, the safest place in the world is a shadow if it is the shadow of the Almighty. But notice the text instructs we must dwell in the shadow of the Most High to abide in the shadow of the Most High. God is a homemaker, not a hotel manager. We cannot merely check in with God on the weekends. Rather, our goal, our target, our mission, our objective is to dwell and abide with God every day. The protection of God is accessed through communion with God. James chapter 4, verse 8 would later ascribe, come near to God and God will come near to you. How do we face our fears? God invites us into the secret place of prayer, the sacred place of peace, that we might discover the strongest place of provision. Verse 1 is a general statement about God, but verse 2 is a personal statement of trust in God. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in whom I trust. It's one thing to be able, my friends, to talk about the Lord. It is another thing to be able to talk to the Lord. Come walk with me for a moment. Because with confident trust, the psalmist testifies about his personal relationship with the Lord using possessive pronouns, my refuge and my fortress, my God. This is provocative language that virtually overthrows the sovereign servant relationship that humans have with the divine. And yet the Lord graciously condescends to be the possession of one who will put their trust in the Lord. Is this your testimony? Psalm 91, verse 2. This I declare about the Lord. He alone is my refuge, my place of safety. He is my God, and I trust in Him. When life crumbles in, when the tests come back positive, when you become gripped with fear, when all news seems to be bad news, thank God there is a secret place of prayer and a sacred place of peace. But hallelujah, glory to His name. The songwriter does not stop there. Along with the secret place and the sacred peace, there is the strongest place. Listen to what he says. This I declare about the Lord. He alone is my refuge, my place of safety. He is my God, and I trust Him. When we get into trouble, there is a fortress. When we get into hardship, there is a refuge. When we get into difficulty, there is safety. When we run into hard circumstances, there is security. When we are feeling weak, there is a strong place. I'm in His safety. The safety of the Lord. And somebody online can testify right now, because God has been safety for you. God has been strong for you, strong in your struggle, strong in your sickness, strong in your stresses, strong in your circumstances. You can testify out loud, and you should. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. Our God is higher than any other. And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand against? The fortress, the protection, the security we have in God is sturdy, stable, and sufficient. Backtrack with me now, if you don't mind, and look at what he calls God right there in verse 1, the Most High. This is the Hebrew name, El Olam, which means supreme, most high, the uppermost, situated on high ground. He also calls him the Almighty. This is the Hebrew name El Shaddai, which means the multi-breasted one, the one who is all sufficient, who is more than enough, who can bless me and bless you at the same time without sparing either one of us everything that we need. He also calls him the Lord. This is the Hebrew name Jehovah, which means I am that I am. I never had a beginning, and I'll never have an ending. I always was. I am, and I always will be. But in verse 2, he also calls him my God. This is the name Elohim, the God who created everything that is, the God who was before was, the God who is before ever became before. This God is our security. This God is our strength. This God is our confidence. This God is our joy. This God is our fortress. This God is our hiding place. Can I talk about it for a moment? Because God provides, write this down, perfect protection. I'm in verse 3. It says, for he will rescue you from every trap and protect you from every deadly disease. God protects us, hallelujah, from the plots and plans and tricks and traps of the enemy. God protects us amid disease and pandemics. God delivers us from enemies and epidemics. God provides perfect protection, but also God provides perpetual protection. Verses 5 and 6. Do not be afraid of the terrors of the night, nor the arrow that flies in the day. Do not dread the disease that stalks in darkness, nor the disaster that strikes at midday. Don't miss it, brothers and sisters. In the face of terrors, arrows, disease, and destruction, we need not succumb to fear. This is not personal courage. This is confident trust. Psalm 23, verse 4, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. That's the kind of faith you got to have. You got to have an even though kind of faith. No matter what happens, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Why? For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. The emphasis of verses 5 through 6 is on the timing of trouble, night or day, darkness or noonday. It does not matter what time it is. It is never time to fall apart. It is never time to quit. It is never time to be afraid. Psalm 121 verse 5 says, the Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade on your right hand. The sun will not harm you. Watch this, by day, that's a time, nor the moon by night. That's a time. We have around the clock, 24/7, 365 protection. We live under the eternal surveillance of Almighty God. God provides perfect protection. God provides perpetual protection, but also God provides prevailing protection. I'm in verse 7 where he says, though 1,000 fall at your side and 10,000 are dying all around you, these evils will not touch you. Act like your MC Hammer for a moment and type in the chat space, can't touch this. These evils will not touch you. You can't touch this. During a raging battle, spreading disease, or tumultuous storm, God's protection prevails. This was the message of Moses at the Red Sea in Exodus 14, 13. For there he said to the people of Israel, do not be afraid, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. Verses 9 and 10 of Psalm 91 says, if you say the Lord is my refuge and you make the Most High your dwelling place, here it is, no harm. Somebody ought to claim it and say it. No harm will overtake you. No disaster. Somebody ought to type it. No disaster shall come near your tent or near your dwelling place or near your abode. Using language employed in earlier verses, the songwriter repeats here, the main message. One commentator noted that love loves to repeat itself. The deepest emotions, like songbirds, have but two or three notes, which they sing over and over again the whole day through. God watches over those who trust in God. But the text adds a bonus. It says God also dispatches angels to watch over those who trust in God. Verse 11, for he will command his angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. Verses 14 through 16 are filled with the promises of God, but as always, these are no blanket promises. The promises of God are fulfilled for those who live in devotion to God. In verse 14 and 15, devotion to God is described in three ways. Don't miss it. Number one, it is in loving God. Somebody type it, love God. Verse 14 states two motivating factors for divine intervention. This verse begins with the first, because he loves me. Woo! That's a shout right there. This is not the typical Hebrew word for love. This word refers to zeal, enthusiasm, passion, and deep longing. It is the difference between loving someone and being in love with someone. This love is evidenced by what you do, not by what you say. Consuming love causes the believer to hold fast to Almighty God. This is the one to whom God gives assurance of protection. Romans 8:28 would later declare, and we know that in all things God works together for the good of those that love God and are called according to his purpose. We are to love God. That's how our devotion is described, but also to know God's name. That's verse 14. It ends with the second motivating factor for divine intervention, because he loves me. That's number one. And he acknowledges my name. That's number two. The Lord's name is more than a means of identification. It is his nature, character, and authority. To know God's name is to know God. It is to speak of the Almighty in the most personal and intimate terms of verse 2. He is my refuge, my fortress, my God, in whom I trust. The Lord does not fulfill his promises for the one who knows his promises. The Lord fulfills his promises for the one who knows his name. We are to know God, to love God. But then thirdly, in verse 14, call on God. Verse 14 reveals and records two conditions for divine assurance, whereas verse 15 pushes us a little further and reveals that you can love God and know God's name and yet live without divine assurance if you fail to pray. Verse 15 says, he will call on me and I will answer him. Note the precondition. You have to call first in order to get an answer. Can I tell you something? Far too many professing believers are functional atheists. They claim to trust God, but they live like God does not exist. They do not call on God in faith, and therefore they receive few, if any, answered prayers. James 4:2 bluntly asserts it, you have not because you ask not. Do you want to live with divine assurance? It happens when you pray. In verses 3, 4, and 11, the psalmist asserts he will to declare God's protective care of the believer. In verses 14 through 16, the Lord speaks for himself. The Lord steps beyond the songwriter and says, I will, six times in those three verses. These I will assurances cover eight divine promises. The promises of verses 14 and 15 are verifiable. Here it is. God will deliver. God will protect. God will answer. God will be with. God will rescue. God will honor you. But what about the promises of verse 16, Pastor? Because trusting and obeying God does not guarantee you will live a long life. Jesus only lived 33 years on this planet. It does not guarantee that you will live a long life, but it does guarantee that you will live a significant life, that your life will have eternal impact. Warren Wiersbe wrote, "It is one thing for doctors to add years to your life, but God adds life to your years and makes your life worthwhile. For God to satisfy you, as the text says, with long life, is for God to show you his salvation, because salvation belongs to the Lord. And God's salvation covers the past, the present, and the future. Because as I said, Jesus only lived 33 years. But look at what God did through his life. Look at what God is doing through his life. Through his life, God healed the sick. Through his life, God raised the dead. Through his life, God fed the hungry. Through his life, God liberated the captives. Through his life, God purchased our salvation. Through his life, God reconciled the human family. Through his life, God justified us. God sanctified us. God qualified us. God verified us. And one of these old days, God will glorify us because of Jesus. He only lived 33 years, but look at what God did through his life. Because of Jesus, we are healed. Because of Jesus, we are saved. Because of Jesus, we are delivered. Because of Jesus, we are protected. Because of Jesus, we are being perfected. Because of Jesus, we have hope. Because of Jesus, we have confidence. Have I got a witness? Is there anybody listening who can say, I thank God, make it personal, for Jesus Christ? Because through Jesus, you are the head and not the tail. Through Jesus, you are a victor and not a victim. Through Jesus, you are triumph and not a tragedy. Through Jesus, you're a winner and not a loser. Through Jesus, you will live and not die. Through Jesus, you can rise, shine, and give God the glory. Say yes. I thank God for Jesus. Although they killed him, they couldn't stop him, because after dying on Friday, God raised him on Sunday with all power in his hands. And God gave him a name that's above every name, above every fear, above every doubt, above every sickness, above every enemy, above every threat, above every anxiety, that at the name of Jesus, every knee must bow and every tongue must confess that Jesus is Lord. That's how I want to end it. Is there anybody online who can testify that Jesus is Lord? Post your emoji, wave your hand, type your amen. Ain't he all right? My time is gone. I thank you for yours. Today is a good day to face your fears. I want to invite you, my brother, my sister, young man, young woman, ladies and gentlemen, wherever you are, whoever you are, I want to invite you to step past your fears into a relationship with Almighty God. I want to invite you to learn the joy of loving God, knowing God, and of calling on God and having God to answer you. All you got to do is call on the Lord and God will respond. How you know, preacher? He's done it for me. No matter what your life has been up to this moment, God is with you right where you are. We want to invite you, not just into membership, but more so into relationship with God and with the church of God. Our team is eager to talk to you, to pray with you, to counsel you, and you can connect with them right now using the URL that's on the bottom of the screen. It's mysbbc.info/gatheringroom. Or if you're on social media, the links are already posted in the chat spaces. Or if you're on our website, look for the welcome banner or just use your digital device to text the word join to 804-643-4769. This is your moment to repair your soul by facing your fear with faith in God. Would you do it right now? Don't miss this marvelous opportunity.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with, oh, thank you, Jesus.
Has God been good to you? Somebody just type all the time in the chat space. It's in that spirit that we prepare today to worship God through the giving of our tithe and our offering and our gifts of love. And it is easy to give at St. Paul's. All of the ways to give are posted on the lower third of this screen. You can give digitally, you can give online, or you can write a check and send it through the U.S. mail. We are grateful for your generous support, and it's in that spirit that we bring our tithe and our offering to God now. Can I pray with you over your gift? Would you pray with me? Holy God, above us, among us, within us, around us, we rejoice this day while you might have chosen to be unknown to us, you have revealed yourself to us in many ways, the ultimate way being in Jesus Christ. We thank you that he gives us the power to overcome all our fears, even financial ones. Each encounter with you calls us to return blessings with worship, compassion, thanksgiving, and service. So this day, we give out of what you have given to us in gratitude for all that you have already done. For those who have given, oh God, their lives on behalf of others, we give this day. We give this day because in love you gave us Christ, that through him we might find eternal life. We give this day that by your Spirit you might lead us to reach out in mercy and grace to all people everywhere with your love. Give us the courage to share our faith with somebody else. In gratitude, we celebrate you, three and yet one. In the name of Jesus, amen, amen, amen. Let's give now.
Your name is strength. Your name is power. A strong tower makes me safe. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, just continue the worship all over the room. Song says, oh Lord, how Lord, how excellent is your name. Your name is strength. Your name is power. A strong tower makes me say,
like you, Lord.
Come on, it's real.
hope that you were blessed by this celebration today. I am always exceptionally blessed to have the opportunity to share with you. I wish I could shake your hand. I'm going to do a digital handshake, so y'all look for it. Not today, but I'm going to do it and announce it in the future. I'd love to shake your hand in any way I could. I look forward to us being together again in physical space. But until then, can I give you the checklist? Number one, be sure to share this stream with somebody today. Our goal every week is no less than 1,000 shares, and you can be one of them. Number two, take a moment to download the GPS document so that you can discuss this message, Facing Fear, with your family and your friends, your neighbors, and your coworkers. And number three, here it is. Let's share our benediction, our final blessing together. The words are printed on the screen. Would you read them with me? I am because we are. We are because God is. You are not alone. Never, never, never. Come on, shake your head when you say it. Never, never, never. Never alone. God is with you, and so are we. Listen to me now. We love you, and there ain't a thing you can do about it except pray fervently, love genuinely, live authentically, and face your fears. Amazing things are waiting for you on the other side of fear. Till next time, God bless you real good. Peace, power.
From St. Paul's Baptist Church, here's the scoop.
Hurt but not hindered, how to move forward. You don't want to miss it. Join us for the Bridge Bible Study every Thursday at 11 a.m. and 7 p.m. It's streamed across all of our platforms. Invite your friends and family. Download the student outline from our website at mysbbc.org or text the word INSIDER to 804-643-4769 to receive it automatically each week. Invite someone to watch with you.
You may not realize it, but the health of your soul is affected by what you experience in life. The ups and downs, challenges, and stress. Caring for your soul goes a long way in keeping you steady, filled with peace, and growing in wisdom. After a year in pandemic, we are all in need of repair. Join our senior pastor, Dr. Lance Watson, for this insightful series as he leads us on a journey of soul repair. Invite somebody to share it with you.
Rain or shine, our fresh food distribution will take place on both June 10th and 24th. Over 1,000 fresh food boxes will be given away. No registration, just show up and pick up at 29 Elm Street, Petersburg, Virginia from 2 to 4 p.m., at 700 East Belt Boulevard in Richmond from 4 to 6 p.m., or at 4247 Creighton Road, Henrico, Virginia from 4 to 6 p.m., or until all food is gone. This is in partnership with Feed More, Produce Source Partners, Save-A-Lot, and Anthem Healthkeepers Plus. Mask is required. Questions? Email outreach at mysbbc.org to volunteer. The rising cost of higher education is one of the biggest foes facing us today. Yet our mission remains the same as our ancestors: to nudge our students to be all that God created them to be. Our faith in God has given us the power to open the doors to opportunity by creating educational scholarships to help our students realize their potential. During the month of June, we are asking every St. Paul supporter to give a special gift of $50 towards our scholarship fund. You can give digitally, online, or by sending a check in the mail. You can designate your gift scholarship to fund gifts for this year or legacy scholarships to help us build a scholarship endowment for the future. Through our Legacy Scholarships program, you can create scholarships to be given in honor of loved ones or yourself. All gifts are tax-deductible, charitable donations. Join us in giving during the month of June.
Never would have made it. Never could have made it without you.
Hello, everybody. My name is Jayla Wilder, and I am a member of the College Connect group here at St. Paul's Baptist Church. I just want to give a special thank you to the St. Paul's Community Foundation for blessing me with this amazing scholarship. I am grateful and thankful for this opportunity that they have given me. It is truly a blessing, and I want to thank you guys again for this opportunity. And I will continue to make you guys proud as I continue my education through college. Thank you again.
Good evening. My name is Malik Grant, and I'm a member of the Blueprint Life Stage of SMB. I'm in the College Connect group, and I also volunteer as a math tutor for SMB. I'm a past recipient of the St. Paul's Community Foundation Scholarship Award, for which I am thankful. Scholarship funds allow me the opportunity to pursue my goal of obtaining a college education by helping to minimize my out-of-pocket expenses, making it affordable for my family and I. I'm a senior this year at VCU, majoring in mathematical sciences with a minor in chemistry. After graduating next year, earning my bachelor's degree, I plan to continue my education, applying to the School of Pharmacy in hopes to pursue my career goal of becoming a pharmacist. I would like to thank the St. Paul's Community Foundation for planting a seed in my life. I would also like to thank the community for their continued support of the foundation through donations. This makes it possible for them to continue to give it to other students like myself who are looking to further their education. Please continue to support the foundation. Thank you.
The St. Paul's Community Foundation will host its annual golf tournament on Friday, September 10th. Proceeds from the tournament support scholarships for our students pursuing higher education. Don't miss the prizes, food, and fun. For information and registration, visit www.mysbbc.info/spcf_2021golf. We are honored and want to celebrate you for accomplishing such an awesome milestone. We are celebrating all 2021 graduates on Sunday, June 27th, during the 10 a.m. worship service. Please email a clear photo of the graduate with their first and last name to deco@myspbc.org by Tuesday, June 15th. Graduates, drive through our North Campus, 4247 Creighton Road, from 3 to 4 p.m. on Sunday, June 27th, to pick up a congratulatory gift. Please wear your cap and gown and register at myspbc.info/gradsun21. That's GRADSUN21. You are invited to participate in a research study about perceptions and belief regarding the COVID-19 vaccine. Your participation is voluntary. In this study, you will be asked a set of questions about the COVID-19 vaccine. The survey will take approximately 8 minutes to complete. Participation is voluntary, and you can exit the survey anytime you want. Here's the link, www.myspbc.info/COVID-vaccine. We give praise to God for our new members thus far in 2021. Every new member is required to complete our DNA seminar. It's a one-day, 90-minute introduction to our church family. The next seminar for adults will convene on Zoom on Monday, June 7th at 6:30 p.m. The next seminar for kids is Sunday, June 27th at 12:30 p.m. Visit mysbbc.info/DNA for Zoom login info. Connect with us for one-on-one prayer or counseling at any time during our Sunday morning worship experience. We'd love to talk with you. Join us in our virtual gathering room at www.myspbc.info/gatheringroom. This year, we will select a governor, lieutenant governor. Make sure you vote. Here are some important dates to take note of during this primary election. June 5th, last day of in-person absentee voting at local registrar. June 8th is election day. Find out who your local legislators are at mysbbc.info/local-legislature. Check out the Virginia Citizen portal to update your registration. Check your polling location and more at elections.virginia.gov/citizen-portal.
Thank you for your time and attention. This has been The Scoop.
Thank you for watching this service from the St. Paul's Baptist Church in Richmond, Virginia. Please look through our website, mysbbc.org, to learn more about our church, about our vision, and how you can support our mission to empower people to grow into the persons that God created them to be.